Welcome to The F Word, a podcast series that examines, excavates, unpicks and reframes forgiveness through the lives of others. I'm Marina Cantacuzino, a journalist from London, founder of the Forgiveness Project charity, and I've built my career investigating how those who face the most complex and devastating things in life find a way through. I'll be talking fortnightly to a guest who's experienced something very difficult or traumatic in their life, but who rather than respond with hate or bitterness has embraced, or at the very least considered, forgiveness as a response to pain. So for this episode of the F Word podcast, I'm going to be talking to Zak Ebrahim, another of the storytellers for the Forgiveness Project. Zak's story begins in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, where he was born in 1983. He had an American mother, a teacher, and an Egyptian father, an engineer. And when he was seven, his father assassinated an ultra-Orthodox anti-Arab rabbi. His father was convicted, imprisoned, and later also found guilty of involvement in the 1993 World Trade Center bombing. So Zak, it's quite a story, and it's great to see you again.
Well, first, thank you very much for inviting me to your podcast. I'm looking forward to the conversation.
So I thought I would take this brief little amount of time that I've got with you to ask you about why you have chosen to share your story so publicly, because I know you've done a TED Talk, you've written a book, and Maya Angelou once said that the greatest agony is to have an untold story held within you. And I suppose what she means is that silence sometimes can really lock people into the trauma. So I'm wondering how telling your story has actually helped you deal with the pain.
It's really helped enormously. For much of my life, I hid my identity from the people closest to me. I would tell people my father had died of a heart attack, and I changed my name when I was 16, so there was no way to connect, you know, my name at least, with my father and his history. During that period, I really felt quite stifled. I felt that I could never truly be sure if my friends would be my friends, if they knew, you know, what my father had done. I'd had so many experiences where people were judging me because of my father's actions. And I truly felt like I couldn't be fully myself. And I knew that there was value in my story, but I really didn't have the self-confidence to think that I was capable of, you know, sharing that message. But I was very fortunate to have people in my life who were very supportive of me and, frankly, who believed in me and were my courage before I had it. So the first time I ever got up on stage, I wasn't even sure if I could speak in a language that human beings could understand. I was very nervous, and but the event went beautifully, and people seemed to really react positively to it. And that was really the first time that I thought to myself, okay, I can do this. And from that point on, I felt like I'd found my sense of purpose. And, you know, that's something that we're all looking for in life. And being able to share my story allowed me to, you know, fully be who I am. And, you know, I think that's one of the greatest gifts that I've gotten from this.
Can we backtrack a bit to you as a child? Can you maybe explain a little bit about the person you were as a boy and how that changed as your father's Islamist extremism kind of took over and you became aware of it as you got older, and whether that changed your personality in any way?
Well, you know, I have a lot of really great memories of my father and my family before he became radicalized. He was a very kind and humorous man. It wasn't until I was about 7 years old that he started spending less time at home, more time at the mosque with these men who were themselves radicalized. And when you're that young, you know, you don't really know how to question what you're being taught. You assume your parents have your best interests at heart, and so you just accept what they tell you is the truth. Well, my father essentially preached an ideology that said that anyone who didn't fit into a very narrow idea of what it means to be good was an enemy. So we were very much taught to be fearful of anyone who didn't look like us, who didn't sound like us, who didn't share the same beliefs as us, and that includes others in the Muslim community. When I talk about isolation, I mean, you know, really truly isolated from being able to interact with anyone who didn't fit into that narrative. So my father would often try and convey stories to me about Muslims and Jews being natural enemies, and that we would know that we were natural enemies from across the room, you know, the moment we saw each other. And I saw this kind of indoctrination being played out with other children in that group. So, you know, really, I don't know that it necessarily changed me so much as formed the foundation of how I would perceive the world. And at that age, you know, as I said, it's impossible to really question what you're being taught.
So I'm presuming that you grew up with your own prejudices then, learnt from your father. And I'm wondering how that played out at school and going forward. And obviously, we're here today talking, and you're a very different man to the boy you were. Can you talk me through how that change occurred, you know, from the bigot to the very broad-minded, peace-loving person who's trying to create a better world?
It's a difficult question. I think that, you know, when I was younger, I was always, you know, looking for my sense of purpose. I knew I wanted to do something that helped people, but I really wasn't sure in what capacity that could be. And it really wasn't until many years later that I was able to escape the isolation that is required to radicalize someone and actually begin to interact with the people that I'd been taught to hate, that I could even begin to question whether or not what I had been taught was the truth. You know, the first time I made a gay friend, what was so impactful in that interaction for me was that I showed this young man hatred for something I frankly knew very little about. And his response to me was to show me kindness. And I had been bullied very badly as a kid. I'd moved 20 times by the time I was 19, so it was a very unstable childhood. And it was impossible for me to ignore that I was doing to him what had been done to me 1,000 times before. And because I was so familiar with that feeling, I naturally couldn't bring myself to want to perpetuate that. And it was his, you know, it was almost an act of defiance. It would have been very easy for him to respond to me in kind and to be hateful. That would have been the easy solution. But instead, he gave me an unexpected reaction. And I think sometimes when the world reacts to you in an unexpected way, it forces you to pause and to think about what it is that you're doing and how it is you perceive the world and whether that's correct or not. So I think that was really what was so profound for me, was in that instant, I had to confront my own hypocrisy.
So that was the first example, probably. I remember you talking before about how John Stewart affected you. And I find it really interesting that someone who was a complete stranger to you but appeared on television could actually have such a profound effect on you. And I think it's really important, actually, for all of us to realize, because that can actually be for good or for bad. In this case, it was for good. Can you just say a bit more about what actually happened?
Jon Stewart, of course, hosted The Daily Show, and so it was an avenue for a young man to become engaged in politics and things like that. And well, growing up, my life was devoid of positive male role models, and I had my mother at home, and she always tried to teach me lessons about treating people the way I wanted to be treated and not judging a book by its cover. But I still felt like I needed that male presence in my life, and you know, as hard as I tried, I couldn't seem to find a positive one. And Jon Stewart was really the first male role model that forced me again to confront the things that I believed. And he did it in such a humorous and intellectual way. And it was just very easy for me to follow along. And he frankly made me feel quite foolish for believing a lot of the things that I believed. And that was just, you know, hugely impactful for me. And it was the first time that I had ever seen a political perspective really outside of what I'd been taught as a child. So it was very new to me and frankly, pretty exciting.
You mentioned your mother there, and I know she was a huge influence. Was she equally drawn in by your father's fundamentalism? And did she also help you develop your own ways of thinking?
Well, you know, as I just said, my mother tried to instill in me, you know, those kind of prototypical lessons about how we want to treat each other. But it serves a larger point to bring up that my mother, while she certainly rejected the extremist aspects of my father's ideology, certainly held her own bigoted views. And, you know, I knew that my mind had been poisoned from a young age. So my mother could at once espouse a belief that we shouldn't judge each other for arbitrary measurements, and at the same time do precisely that. At the same time, I think my mother knew that my father wanted to be a part of the jihadi movement that was taking place at the time, and that essentially came in the form of my father very much wanting to go fight in the Afghan war. After my experiences having the opportunity to interact with people who are different from me, I began to realize the way I viewed the world was changing. And my mother was someone that I would go to have these kinds of conversations with. And so one day I sat down with her and I started to explain to her my beliefs. And frankly, I think while I did it, I was maybe convincing her.
Actually, I just want to cut in here to add a tiny bit from Zak's 2014 TED Talk, which has now been viewed nearly 6 million times.
One day I had a conversation with my mother about how my worldview was starting to change. And she said something to me that I will hold dear to my heart for as long as I live. She looked at me with the weary eyes of someone who'd experienced enough dogmatism to last a lifetime and said, "I'm tired of hating people."
And it became so apparent to me just how much energy it took to hold that hatred inside of you. Not, ultimately that hatred is founded in fear of what we don't understand, of people that we don't understand. And I've talked with so many people who had been indoctrinated into similar ideologies. And one, I think, of the common themes among so many of us is that it is exhausting having to have those beliefs. And that given the opportunity, I think the vast majority of people who have been radicalized would happily accept a belief system that was, more based in equality. But a lot of times the environment that we live in doesn't allow us to find a path.
One of my favorite quotes is by James Baldwin, the writer, the American writer, and he says, "One of the reasons people cling to their hate so stubbornly is because they believe once hate has gone, they'll be forced to deal with their pain." And that really struck me. It's very, very profound.
It certainly speaks to the evolution of the things that I had felt. By the time I was 20, 21 years old, I looked at myself and I thought, wow, I've escaped so much of this, so much of these traumatic experiences relatively unscathed. And it really wasn't until I was in my mid to late 20s that I began to understand just how much anger and resentment that I had because of the difficulties in my past. And, as a writer, you hear all the time about it being a very cathartic experience, and I spent years sitting down by myself in my living room writing about the worst experiences of my life, and frankly, it was horrible. I kept waiting for that moment that I would start to feel better, and it seemed like it would never come. But eventually it did. I began to have a more fuller understanding of what I felt and the reasons that I felt it. So I was able to go from the how to the why. And if you can't get to the why, then you cannot find meaning in your experience. And that was really what I understood eventually that I was searching for. I was trying to find meaning from the experiences that I'd had. And then it was several years after that before I could really feel like I was in control of a lot of the emotions that I felt. It was frankly a really painful experience, but I'm not sure that it's something that I can ever fully get rid of, but I'm certainly a better person because of it.
And we haven't spoken about your feelings towards your father since he was convicted and imprisoned and still is in prison. So I'm just wondering, does forgiveness come into this story somewhere?
That's a very good question and a very complicated question. It's something that I go back and forth with, and I think about what I have control over and what I don't. For example, one of the things that I really struggle with is being in communication with my father. Our communication over the years has been sporadic and unhealthy, for me anyway. And, I consider myself an empathetic person, and I realize that there are only two things that my father really wants from his prison cell, and that is either his freedom or a relationship with his family. And there's only one of those things that I can control or that I could believe that he deserves. So I feel a guilt in my own heart that I cannot bring myself to give him some relief from that. Forgiveness, to me, I think I had to frame it in a way to say that I had to forgive him so that I could forgive myself. Certainly I can't forgive him for the ways that his actions affected other people, but for me personally, I think I had to forgive the man that he was and the actions that he committed so that I could find peace. So, you know, in a way it was a selfish kind of act, but, at times we need to be selfish.
That makes perfect sense. And it also leads me to ask you whether you have sought to meet him, to correspond with him, to have any sort of dialogue at all.
Well, I've been speaking publicly for about 10 years now. And after the very first speech that I gave, I got back to my hotel room and there was an email from one of his lawyers saying that your father had been looking for you for years. I was actually on the cover of the Philadelphia Daily News that morning, and I believe that's how his lawyer found out. And I was so freaked out by the email, I never even responded. But a few years after that, I got an email from the Bureau of Prisons saying that my father wanted to begin email communication with me, and I had 10 days to decide yes or no. So I took this opportunity to communicate with him. He was in the process of going through appeals at the time, and so I don't think that he could be as fully transparent, perhaps, as he wanted to be. But when I asked him these questions, you know, that I'd thought about for much of my life, he frankly responded in a very negative way. He told me that I was stupid for asking him these questions, and even accused me of somehow trying to implicate him so that his appeal process would fail. And, you know, that frankly devastated me. I had put so much importance in those questions and in his answers. And for months, at that point, the conversation had become very unhealthy, so I decided to end communication with him. And for some time after that, I really felt very depressed about not having been able to find those answers. And one morning, I woke up and I felt relief, and I wasn't even sure why. And as I thought about it more, I realized that my father was incapable of giving me the answers that I was searching for because his ideology dictated that he see the world in a black and white lens, one in which, you know, all of the arbitrary ways that people who hold those kinds of radical ideologies judge others made him incapable of giving me a well-rounded or educated, frankly, response. So realizing that, in a sense, set me free. I no longer needed his answers.
That's really interesting because I often talk about how forgiveness is quite useful when something can't be repaired, when someone who's hurt you is unable to show remorse. Because if it can be repaired, then a kind of reconciliation can happen. But actually, forgiveness is useful when reconciliation can't happen. And forgiveness in the sense of letting go and acceptance. And it seems that that's in a way what happened to you very suddenly without you having to think it through. It was just a very natural process.
Well, I think that speaks to time, frankly. As I get older and I realize that, you know, as you're saying, some things cannot be fixed. Some things can be broken to the point that they cannot be repaired. It was a long time learning that lesson. I think I needed to grow and experience the world and frankly to break things and to not be able to repair things to understand that. For me, my relationship with my father, you know, evolved so much over time. When I was younger and he was in prison, I couldn't verbalize it. You know, I couldn't understand it fully, but I knew that I needed a father. Once I was into my mid-teens, you know, I was in search of that male role model who could instill in me a sense of self-confidence, who could, you know, instill wisdom in me. As I got into my 20s, you know, my perspective changed. I didn't need a father figure anymore. And I think that was perhaps the time where I could begin to process a lot of the things that had happened between my father and I. So I try and convey in my message just how important it is that we be patient with ourselves and that we give ourselves the time that we need. You know, everyone wants to feel better. We want to feel whole. We want to feel healed. and forcing it sometimes can make it worse. And I think, you know, in some ways, as I began to write, I was trying to force it. And it really took me a long time of going through that process to realize, as hard as you work, sometimes it just takes time and you have to be patient.
So Zak, just tell me a little bit about what you're doing now and how you're using your story in ways that can impact people most.
A lot of what I talk about has started to focus on mental health, my own, you know, using my own experiences and difficulties and battling depression and things like that to make others know that it's okay to have those conversations. And in a sense, to show people that, you know, there is a strength in vulnerability. So my process has evolved over the years, and speaking is the thing that has given me a sense of purpose in life. Sometimes, you know, it can be quite draining, but, you know, nothing good comes easy. And, you know, my hope is, you know, simply that the work that I do and the feeling that it gives me continue to energize me and motivate me to, you know, keep moving forward. But there is a limit to the efficacy. You know, it's wonderful to inspire people in an hour or an hour and a half, but that is not something I believe that can lead to systemic change. What is required is a program in place that can reinforce lessons. So I began a nonprofit organization with the hopes of creating, at this moment, two separate programs. One is an art box therapy program where we provide Skype lessons to people who have experienced traumatic events all over the world. We will mail them a box of materials that allows them to create art. And we provide lessons over Skype for that. The other aspect of the nonprofit is building a program that we can take into schools and communities that reinforce communication between groups that don't have the opportunity to interact with one another. I think ultimately that is the most effective way to reduce the ability for extremist groups to find new recruits. When a group like ISIS, for example, attacks a Western country, they do not do it with the thought that they are an existential threat to that government. Their goal is to create division in society so that we may be more fearful of each other because of the color of our skin or the sound of our names or the length of our beards. Knowing their tactics allows us to react in a better way. And I think that the best way to do that is, as I said, to try and solidify the bonds between communities that don't have that opportunity.
That's really interesting. I'm particularly interested in the fact that you're using art as well as a way through, because the longer I work in this field of restorative justice and conflict resolution, the more I think that actually reaching people through storytelling is very powerful, but to get them involved in creative activities and using their imagination and letting go of the mind in a way is so powerful. So good luck with that. Sounds absolutely amazing. And I want to thank you so much, Zak, for talking to me. It's wonderful to see you again.
Thank you. It's my pleasure.
Thank you for listening to the F Word podcast. To dig a bit deeper around some of the themes we've talked about, do check out the show notes by going to theforgivenessproject.com/F Word podcast. And from there, you can also explore the Forgiveness Project website, which over the years has collected and shared many more stories of how people have transformed the darkest of situations. I also want to invite you to join the F Word Podcast Facebook group, especially if you have more to discuss or share. Again, to find the link, go to theforgivenessproject.com/F Word Podcast. And finally, all these podcasts have grown out of years of trying to shift the narrative of our time away from one of hate and division towards empathy and understanding. So if you've enjoyed this podcast, please do consider donating even just the smallest amount to help us continue our work. All details of how to do this, again, are on the show notes page of our website. But most of all, I hope you'll join me again. Next time, I'm going to be talking to Liz Cashin. It's a story about guilt, traumatic memory, self-forgiveness, and how you learn to heal when you're the cause of a tragic accident.